Thank you very much to Rabbi Ames for hosting this event, and also to Rabbi Middleman for sponsoring this event, and also thanks very much to Ross Levine and Michael Gottlieb for organizing the event. I've really had the great pleasure of getting to know and form a friendship with Michael in the process of putting this program together, and we're both NIHers, so not only did we get to gossip about Jewish genetics, we also got to gossip about the NIH, which has its own very rich content to talk about. Interestingly, when I decided that I wanted to organize the Jewish HapMap project in, I guess it was 2006, I called Francis Collins, who was then the director of the National Human Genome Research Institute, is now the director of the NIH. And he had organized a project called the HapMap Project, which was an effort to map the genomes of different population groups. And I said to him, you know, Francis, I think it would be a really good idea to organize a Jewish HapMap Project. And he said to me, well, you know, Harry, my advisors tell me that we'll learn everything that we need to know about the Jews from studying Europeans. And so I hope to prove to you today that although Francis is frequently right, seldom in doubt, that in fact the genetic history of the Jews is its own very very rich subject of investigation. So, of course, the focus of our discussion today is very much about who are the Jews. And one way of defining Jews is by where they live. And we see that there are about 14 million Jews in the world today. About half live in the United States, about half live in Israel. Jews, not surprisingly, if you are a very metropolitan people, 70% of world Jewry live in 15 metropolitan areas. I think that's nice for rabbis because they get to live in metropolitan areas as well. And New York is, as well known to all of us here, the second largest Jewish city in the world, with about 15% of the world's Jewish population. And of the Jews in the United States, about 90% are Ashkenazi Jews, Jews of Eastern European origin. We know that most of us here are probably Ashkenazi Jews, but perhaps not all. And our other major Jewish diaspora groups in New York City are Syrian Jews and Iranian Jews and Iraqi Jews. But overall, about 90% of the population of the United States is comprised of Ashkenazi Jews, and the other 10% Jews of other Jewish diaspora groups. And I would say, for instance, for those of you who are Ashkenazi Jews, that if you've never gone to an Iranian Jewish restaurant for a meal, you should afford yourself the opportunity, because it is an absolutely wonderful experience. And I should say that for me, a major reason for my deciding to do work about the population genetics of Jewish people was to develop an understanding of different Jewish diaspora groups, to understand the diaspora, and in turn, to encourage Jews to learn more about each other, because so much of our history has been spent in the diaspora, and it has been a very rich history. So in turn, here in New York City, we are a major population. We comprise about 13% of the population. New York, again, of course, that is very well known to you. You know that we have a major imprint on the fabric of life here in New York City. And it is certainly well known to you that New York is an ethnically rich place with representation of people from all over the world. From the point of view of being a human geneticist, it is an absolutely wonderful place to be because the world's population has come to us. We haven't had to go to them, although as you will see, I've frequently chosen to go other places to study populations because there is so much that one can learn from them. So the question of who are the Jews or who is a Jew is one that Jews themselves have grappled with for a very long period of time. Jews a century ago were grappling with this issue. Among them was Albert Einstein, who was invited by the Berlin rabbis to join a shul. And I'm sorry to say, Rabbi Middleton, that he chose not to. But nonetheless, he loved the Jews, and the Jews in turn, you know, loved him. He was the most famous Jew of the 20th century, and he was offered the presidency of Israel, an honor that he turned down. He said, I know that the word Jew is ambiguous in that it refers to nationality and origin and to the faith. And he said, I'm a Jew in the first sense, not the second. And what he's saying there is that there is you know, both a religious basis to Jewishness that we're all familiar with, and that there is, as Michael said, an ancestral as well as cultural and perhaps national basis to Judaism. We can get into the topic more of nationalism. I prefer to steer away from that from the moment. Before the moment, it was a topic that, of course, became quite popular in the 19th century as nation states emerged. And the question of, you know, are the Jews a nation was brought to the fore with Zionism. But Einstein also envisioned that there was a type of Jewish exceptionalism in which he said the pursuit of knowledge for its own sake, an almost fanatical love of justice, and the desire for personal independence. These are the features of the Jewish tradition which make me thank my lucky stars that I belong to it. And that is in a personal memoir that he wrote fairly early in his life in 1931 called The World As I See It, which I would commend to you to read because it's really quite interesting. But Einstein was building on a debate that went well into the 19th century. And it was an active debate both in Europe and the United States. One of the major participants in this debate was Joseph Jacobs, who was a Jewish polymath, born in Australia, educated at Cambridge, subsequently in the laboratory of Francis Galton, Charles Darwin's cousin, the founder of eugenics, a major player in the history of genetics. Jacobs went on to come here to New York and to become the editor of the Jewish Encyclopedia. And in his entry on anthropology, he said the remarkable unity of resemblance among Jews, even in different climes, seems to imply a common descent. There was this idea in the late 19th century that there was a common genetic basis to being Jewish. In fact, Jacobs had an appreciation for genetics because he became good friends with Bateson, among the people who popularized Mendel's discoveries in the beginning of the 20th century. And of course, there were no sequenced genomes in the 1880s and the 1890s. Only the tools of physical anthropology were available at that time, such as looking at pigmentation or measuring head size. And that's what caused Jacobs and his fellow physical anthropologists, including Maurice Fishburne, who was a professor of medicine at NYU, to comment about a common appearance among Jews, which of course many of us today comment about as well. And many of us today, of course, play the game of look-see, you know, is he or isn't he? You know, looking at the folks on the subway and, or, you know, gossiping among our friends about, you know, who looks Jewish and who doesn't look Jewish. In fact, Maurice Fishburne said in his 1911 book, The Jews, a Study of Race and Environment, one can pick out a Jew from among 1,000 non-Jews without difficulty. And I rather suspect that many of us in this room feel that we can do that as well, which may or may not be accurate, but is certainly a very popular view that exists within the Jewish community itself. And all of these images are photographs that are in this rather wonderful book called Diaspora by Frederick Brenner. Frederick is shown right here. Whoops, let's go back. Signing a copy of his book at the JCC of the Upper West Side several years ago. And I'll leave it to you to decide whether these Jews look alike or whether they look different in the various photographs. Certainly, many of them are dressed quite differently, indicating that their particular diaspora groups, you know, have had their own distinctive cultures, including styles of dress. So here's what I'd like to cover during my talk. Genetic analysis informs our understanding about the formation of the Jewish people, and in turn that historical studies support the genetic observations. I think that we are moving towards what Edmund Wilson called a consilience view between science and history, which should make a program like Sinai and Synapses feel happy, because consilience is something that we want to achieve within our society. Jewish genealogists are developing their own narratives of history. I'll tell you a little bit about my foray, but there are really some wonderful things that are being done by lay genealogists in the Jewish community. And then this really quite interesting finding in my own work and more recently in others, that descendants of conversos can be found throughout Latin America. To summarize this view about a genetic basis for Jewish history, I wrote in 2012 in my book, Legacy, A Genetic History of the Jewish People. So Jewishness at a genetic level can be characterized as a tapestry with threads being represented as shared segments of DNA, and no single thread being required for composition of the tapestry. The genetic affiliation of any individual might be higher for a specific Jewish group rather than for the Jewish people as a whole. So I'm saying there are several things. First of all, the genetics is complicated. If we have 3 billion base pairs of DNA, there are going to be, you know, many different strands, and those strands are going to come from a variety of ancestral sources. But for some of us, you know, those strands, but certainly not all, may have been present at Sinai, and other strands got woven in. during the course of our history. And I think over the course of the day, we will be talking about how those various strands got woven into our genomes. In turn, as diaspora communities that married within our own ranks, we formed our own distinctive populations. So indeed, we can tell an Ashkenazi Jew apart from a Sephardic Jew at a genetic level. But in turn, there is going to be a commonality among Jewish people that one is going to be able to identify from doing genetic analysis. And that we have always been welcoming towards the convert, who in turn has contributed his strands or her strands into our tapestry. And we can identify those strands over our history by our contemporary genetic analysis. So, of course, all scientists like to show data, because data matters. Our observations are data-driven. And this is from a study that was the Jewish HapMap project, and it was an analysis of Jewish populations from Europe and from the Middle East. Subsequently, we extended it to 17 different Jewish diaspora groups. And the key feature about this is that Jewish populations tend to cluster together. It's called principal component analysis. But just to point out, here's the Jewish cluster, and the Jews are falling is here. And the Jews, not surprisingly, are falling between European populations and Middle Eastern non-Jewish populations, reflecting what we've come to see as a dual history, especially for European Jews. As we break this up further, we can see that individual groups tend to form their own clusters, as I mentioned just a moment ago. So here are Iraqi Jews, here are Iranian Jews, here are Ashkenazi Jews, here are Syrian Jews, here are Sephardic Jews, whom I characterized as Greek and Turkish Jews. Now, when I was organizing this project, I thought, well, great, we'd like to recruit Sephardic Jews to participate in the project. So I contacted Rabbi Angel at the Spanish and Portuguese Synagogue and said, can we find some Sephardic Jews to recruit at your synagogue? And he said to me, very few. But if you go to Seattle, you'll be able to recruit Sephardic Jews, because the Turkish Jews who came to the United States at the turn of the 20th century did not stay in New York. They went to Seattle. And indeed they did, and indeed they were quite welcoming of me for this project. And I had the opportunity to be Shomer Shabbat with them and to do their recruitment. And the genetics really didn't lie, because within this group of Greek and Turkish Jews were also Greek Jews that Eitan Friedman and I recruited from Thessaloniki and Athens, and they did form their own cluster. When we asked when we told the Turkish Jews in Istanbul that we wanted to come visit, after initially telling us that we would be welcome, they subsequently declined to have us come, because, as we know, in Turkey, it is more important to be Turkish than to be a member of an ethnic minority, and therefore one doesn't want to stand out. And therefore, we didn't do recruitment there to be respectful of the people. Now, the findings were not peculiar to us. There was a comparable effort that was going on by my good friends, Daron Bahar and Carl Skorecki, Carl is actually a good friend of John Templeton, a sponsor of our symposium today. And they published an article a week after ours, essentially showing the same thing. Jewish populations tend to cluster together. They have dual origins between Middle Eastern European, subsequently North African populations. Of course, it's quite wonderful for a scientist when you see that there is going to be corroboration of your study, a week after you've made your own original observation. As I mentioned, we went on to extend this to other Jewish diaspora groups. This is a different way of representing the data. It's referred to as a nearest neighbor joining tree. This is Chris Campbell, who worked in my lab for a number of years and was the first author of this paper. And makes the point that each of these Jewish groups is its own distinctive branch on the nearest neighbor joining tree. And that in terms of the placement of the branches, the European Jews are close to one another, the North African Jews are close to one another, and the Middle Eastern Jews are close to one another. So this defines the three major branches of the Jewish diaspora, European, Middle Eastern, and North African. And from the point of view of Ashkenazi and Sephardic Jews, it tells us that they both had common Southern European origins. It fits our general understanding that would like to resolve at greater level now that Ashkenazi Jews are the descendants of Jews who lived in Southern Europe, likely Italy, at the time of classical antiquity, subsequently migrated over the Alps into the Rhine Valley, and then subsequently when expelled from Germany and France, migrated to Poland and Lithuania. So the nearest neighbor joining tree kind of tells the whole story. Yemenite Jews are a bit of an outlier here. Indian Jews, both B'nai Israel and Cochini, whom we studied, are also outliers, but also clearly have demonstrable Middle Eastern ancestry. Another way we did our studies, though, and this is where this whole tapestry sort of metaphor comes from, is not just by looking at individual markers that are sprinkled throughout the genome, but actually building segments from these. We call these IDD segments. Some people refer to these as haplotypes. We can use computational techniques to identify these segments, identify these lanes, look whether they're shared within a population or between populations. It's a way of measuring kinship within a population. So you and your children, for instance, are going to share half your segments because, as we heard from Michael, that's the way that this Mendelian genetics works. If there tends to be consanguinity within a population or endogamy within a population, consanguinity is marrying within a family, endogamy is marrying within a population, then the shared segments between any two random individuals may be relatively high. And so the upper part of this panel actually measures that. And what it tells us is that the endogamy within some of these groups was quite significant, so that any two Libyan Jews are going to be related to one another as one would observe for first cousins once removed. For Iranian Jews, it would be about third cousins, and for Ashkenazi Jews, it would be what we would observe for fourth to fifth cousins. Now, adding up these IBD segments, these strands between groups, well, in fact, we see that there is a very substantial sharing within the Jewish groups that are shown in orange here. Jewish, non-Jewish is being compared in green, and non-Jewish, non-Jewish is being compared in blue. So Jewish populations, one between another, have a high degree of segmental sharing, which is different from what is observed between Jewish and non-Jewish groups. So this is the pictorial representation of the tapestry of threads that links the Jewish people together. Now, the genomic information can be analyzed in other ways to see, well, what was the relative population size at different points in the history? Did the population go through a bottleneck, meaning that there were relatively many people and then a group migrated to a new place, such as over the Alps and into the Rhine Valley, and then did the population expand? And this is from a study that Shai Carmi did as part of our Ashkenazi Genome Consortium. And it tells us the history of Ashkenazi Jews, that there was a group of Middle Eastern progenitors and a group of Southern European progenitors who got together. We'll talk about that more in just a minute. And they formed a population. The population had a bottleneck. It may have had as few as 350 to 1,000 people who went over the Alps. And then it expanded. And in fact, it expanded so dramatically that it went from the size of 50,000 in 1500 to 5 million in 1900, and that phenomenon has been referred to as the demographic miracle. Now, many of you may be thinking, but Ashkenazi Jews are, you know, Eastern European. You know, we know that because my family came from, you know, Odessa or Vilna. And indeed, that's true. And did we have any contact with Eastern Europeans while we lived in Eastern Europe? And the answer is yes. And that, in turn, is demonstrable in the genomes of contemporary Jewish, Ashkenazi Jewish individuals, and measured by Shai as being on the order of 15 to 25%. So this demographic miracle can be visualized at the genomic level as well. Sequencing DNA is really quite a robust tool that we have. And as Michael mentioned to you, with each replication of our genome, there are going to be errors introduced. You know, we refer to those as mutations. And in a rapidly growing population, there will be a very high frequency of new mutations, new variants that are demonstrable in the genome. And that is true for Ashkenazi Jews compared to other populations. There is a high frequency of rare variants that are found in unique individuals or two individuals within the population study. And here is a comparison between Ashkenazi Jews and Flemish. In the study that came out from the Ashkenazi Genome Consortium, and showing that the novel variants in the Ashkenazi Jews are higher. It's 1.5% compared to 1%, but that, in fact, is significant when one is looking at a population over a span of hundreds of years. So here is what the Jewish diaspora looked like in 1900. A chunk of the Jewish diaspora had moved to the United States by then, but still many Jews lived in Europe, and by far the largest group of Jews were Ashkenazi and lived in Eastern Europe. was the largest country with regard to its Jewish population, and sizable populations in other European countries as well, and smaller populations in the diaspora of Southern Europe, the Middle East, and North Africa. So I've come to the point of view that historical studies support genetic observations. First of all, Jews welcome strangers, and that goes back to the original founding stories of the Jews. Jews were migratory. They did not just live in Judea until the time of the fall of the Second Temple and then dispersed throughout the world. Jews were, a very significant population, both in the Persian and Roman empires. And Jews were at home in Judea, the Roman Empire, and Spain, until, alas, they weren't. So from Genesis, we know that the covenant of Judaism includes the native-born and the convert. And so in Genesis 12, it says, throughout your generations, every male among you shall be circumcised when he is 8 days old, including the slave born in your house and the one bought with your money from any foreigner who is not your offspring. So from the foundation of Judaism, we've been welcoming other people in who were willing to observe the covenant. So we may not all have ancestors who were present at Sinai because we've been welcoming people from the very earliest days of Judaism. And the covenant, of course, has been expanded a bit so that to convert to Judaism requires not only circumcision, but also participation in the Beit Din and in a mikvah. But if you follow the precepts of religious conversion, then you become a fully accepted member of the community. And so this has always been part of the story of the Jewish people, and not surprisingly should be reflected in their strands of DNA. And here we see an estimate of how Jewish demography has changed over time. Jews are thought to have been a very significant force in the Roman Empire. Sala Baron, the very esteemed Jewish historian at Columbia University, who wrote a very lengthy history, multi-tone version of the history of the Jewish people, claimed that the population of Jews in the Roman Empire may have been as high as 6 million people, that 10% of the population of the Roman Empire may have been Jewish. My research partner, Leonard Rutgers, whom I'll show you in just a minute, and I have argued about this a lot. I think from ancient studies of DNA, which we're talking about doing now, as you heard, it will give us new insights into the demography of the Jews in the Roman Empire. But we know from our historical sources, such as Josephus, the leading Jewish Roman historian of the time, that Jews were everywhere in the Roman Empire, from North Africa to Armenia, from Persia to Rome. There were thriving Jewish communities, primarily in large cities, but also in towns and even villages. Josephus, quoting Strabo, the Greek historian and geographer, wrote, "Now these Jews have already gotten into all cities, and it's hard to find a place in the habitable earth that has not admitted this tribe of man and is not possessed by them." And the archaeological records, so a third piece of evidence, so genetics, history, archaeology tends to support this as well. If we look at the location of archaeological sites for Jewish settlement in the time of classical antiquity. Well, it's just what Josephus said. You know, it was all over the Mediterranean basin in both the Roman and Persian empires. And Leonard, shown here at ease of his house in the Netherlands, says, well, Jews lived throughout the ancient world and were, you know, at ease. It wasn't unusual to be Jewish in the Roman Empire. Jews were comfortable there. He said, over the last century or so, scholars working on the ancient Jewish diaspora have been overwhelmed by the fact that archaeological evidence testifying to the presence of Jewish communities has turned up in virtually every corner of the Roman world and beyond. What has surprised me even more is the degree to which all these diaspora communities seem to have been integrated into the larger cultural environment characteristic of the Roman world. So they spoke Greek, which was a lingua franca of the time, and they used Roman decoration on their tombs, a major research interest of Leonard's. And he goes on to say, as a result, especially from the 1970s onward, a consensus has begun to emerge according to which overall Roman period diaspora Jews were culturally at ease. And so one of the bits of evidence for this is looking at the site of Sardis in Turkey, which had a Jewish and pagan community. And the synagogue was integrated into the gymnasium. You know, so the synagogue was, in fact, an integral part of the community. And not only Jews, but others who were characterized as God-fearers. So, you know, people who, like Jews, wanted to participate in their ceremonies. Came to the synagogue as well. And here's a German map that makes the case for the synagogue being integrated into the gymnasium in Sardis. And here are the frescoes from Dura Europos. Dura Europos is a site in Syria. It was at the fringe of the Roman Empire. It is a settlement that was equally Jewish, Christian, and pagan. These frescoes are now in the National Museum of Syria, alas. Whether they have been preserved, we don't know. One can only hope. Replicas of them are available at Yale University and were on display here in New York several years ago at the Center for the Study of the Ancient World at NYU. And they're really very well preserved and really quite remarkable. And first of all, they were an integral part of life in Dura Europos. But they're showing us that many of the stories that we talk about today are exactly the stories that people were painting about in the third century. So here's baby Moses in the Nile. Here's the Exodus from Egypt. Here is the golden calf. Sorry, I didn't do justice to Abraham, but here he is right here. And here is Mordecai and Esther on a horse. So exactly the same stories that, you know, we think of as biblical stories people were painting, you know, in the third century. So there is a certain continuity to Jewish history. So in terms of what else we know, well, Jewish genealogists are developing their own narratives of Jewish history. I'll tell you a little bit about my narrative in that regard. I am by no means sophisticated with this at all compared to what some Jewish genealogists, including some who may be present in this room, may know. And I'm always nervous that someone's going to come along at a talk like this and stump me with, you know, a question that, you know, I'm not going to be able to answer. This will tell you a bit about my history. So in my patrilineal line, my family came from Ukraine, and my great-grandfather Shmuel was born in Rovna, Ukraine. He moved to the shtetl of Shepetovka, where my grandfather Harry was born. Harry came to the United States early in the 20th century. And he had four brothers. Only he and his brother Herman are shown here. When I asked my cousin, not Stephen, another cousin, if he wanted to participate in our Y chromosomal study, he declined because he pointed out, well, you know, suppose we don't match, you know, one of us might learn something, you know, that we don't want to know about our grandmothers, which I don't think our grandmothers would have done stuff like that, but yeah, but nonetheless, my cousin Stephen did participate, and we did match, so our Y chromosome was in fact transmitted from his grandfather and my great-grandfather. And one of my NYU research neighbors was great friends with Mitchell Osper, shown here, who's a judge in New Jersey. And my research partner kept bugging me, well, you know, why don't you and Mitchell do a study, you know, to find out, you know, whether you're related to each other, since Oscar is such a rare name. And so he and his brother did, and then subsequently we recruited Elliot Oscar from Arizona to participate as well. And so we had a common Jewish Y chromosomal haplotype called E3B. It was at the time that we did the study. It's now called E1A1A. And so, yeah, it suggested, you know, we were from a common Ashkenazi Jewish stock. But when the Y chromosomes were analyzed more carefully, in fact, there was a match in only 11 out of 25 polymorphic markers. It's possible to look at the rate of deviation of these polymorphic markers as a molecular clock. And so our time to a common ancestor was about 1,000 years ago. So, you know, I said to my kids, well, you know, there are the us Osters and the them Osters, you know, without, you know, making, you know, any claims, you know, who might be, you know, the better Osters in, you know, all of this. It had not been my intention to share my results, but the company with which we did the test, you know, shared the result. And Hadar Israf, who was a biologist at SUNY Buffalo, wrote to me and said, well, you know, in fact, we match. And when we look at our polymorphic markers on the Y chromosome, since it's all, you know, one chromosome being transmitted together, we matched at 25 of 25 polymorphic markers. So the time to a common ancestor was about 7 to 8 generations ago. So you might notice, well, you know, not only did my great-grandfather come from the shtetl in Ukraine, but also his great-grandfather came from Mezhibosh, another shtetl in the Ukraine. And if you use Google Maps to measure the distance between these two shtetls, it's about 20 kilometers. So very plausible that we indeed had a common male ancestor within the last 7 to 8 generations. Interestingly, he told me that in their family lore, that they were told that they had been descended from a Hasidic Jew named Eliezer de Gutter, and that Eliezer had wished on his descendants that they should be poor for the next seven generations. So I dutifully, you know, sent this off to my wife, and she wrote back to me and said, well, you know, fortunately for you, you know, you weren't descended from Eliezer. But who knows? This is just a small part of what Jewish genealogists are doing. A major player among Jewish genealogical societies is Adam Brown, who is an immediate past president of the International Association of Jewish Genealogical Societies. He and his fellow genealogists and Bennett Greenspan from Family Tree DNA have been working to create a genetic census of the Jewish people. We've participated with our samples from the Jewish HapMap project in his studies to look at the diversity of Y chromosomes and when they arose over the course of genetic history. One of the interesting features of his work with Y chromosomes is that the diversity of Y chromosomes among Ashkenazi Jews is much greater than it is among Sephardic or Middle Eastern Jews, you know, reflecting the fact that there has been, you know, this much greater population growth that has occurred among Ashkenazi Jews, and just, you know, reflecting what the population history has been there. If you look on their website, as I did last month in preparation for this talk today, well, the featured issue was Sephardic tombstones found in Suriname have Jewish names. And that follows on to the last major point that I'd like to make, which is that Converso Jews came to the New World, left their genetic imprint, and in turn, this can be detected in the genomes of contemporary Latin American, Latino, and Hispanic people who did not necessarily know about their Jewish history. So descendants of Converso Jews can be found throughout Latin America. And I'm going to take a little bit of a backdoor into this. Those of us who were, you know, Johns Hopkins tend to, you know, idealize the place. Victor McCusick was my professor at Johns Hopkins. He was a great cataloger of genetic diseases. And he, for instance, was the first to catalog the prevalence of certain genetic diseases among Ashkenazi Jews in this study in 1967, Inherited Neurologic Diseases of Ashkenazi Jewry, demographic data suggesting non-random gene frequencies. And, you know, frequently when people ask me about, you know, what do you do and what do you do with Jewish genetics, you know, they will say, well, isn't this about Tay-Sachs disease? And isn't this about, you know, breast cancer susceptibility? And the answer, of course, is yes, but as I hope I've convinced you so far today, it is about, you know, so much more. But before we had these, you know, fully sequenced genomes, we had these diseases, and these were our genetic markers. McCusick was very influenced in his thinking about this by Chaim Shiva, who is a major player in Israeli public health, Israeli genetics. He identified the prevalence of a condition that we call G6PD deficiency among non-Ashkenazi Jews in Israel. And in this quote from McCusick, he's talking about how when he went to visit Sheba in Israel in the 1960s, Sheba was pointing out to him there are these different genetic conditions that arise in different Jewish populations and that they occur as markers within those populations. So following the guidance of McCusick, I became a cataloger of genetic diseases among Jewish populations. And you know, interestingly, there are these many different disorders, some quite rare, some cases quite common that occur in different Jewish populations. Some conditions tend to be relatively common within certain groups. We don't really know why that is. We don't know, for instance, whether natural selection has played an important role in that. It's a question that I'm hoping to touch on in the next phase of our study. But there is also this interesting phenomenon of conditions that are shared across populations. So among these, the clotting disorder, combined factors 5 and 8 deficiency found in Tunisian and Iranian Jews, factor 7 deficiency found in Moroccan and Iranian Jews, the common BRCA1 so-called Ashkenazi Jewish mutation being found in Iraqi Jews. So these strands of DNA include strands with disease mutations. And we've built more detailed catalogs over time. This shows the circa 1912 catalog for Ashkenazi Jews. Don't want to belabor the point right now, we'll come back to it later. But the conditions start popping up in non-Jewish locations, such as Bloom syndrome in Central America and breast cancer predisposition from the common BRCA1 mutation among the Hispano population of Southern Colorado, or Laronne syndrome, a dwarfing condition from the mutation in the growth hormone receptor gene in Ecuador and Brazil. And so we went on to study these people, mindful of the fact that some estimates of Converso Jewry place them at as high as 30% of New World populations that the Jews of Spain and Portugal had to get out. You know, they had to go somewhere, you know, in order to survive. And many of them came to the New World, as Stanley Cordes wrote in his book, To the Ends of the Earth, in order to escape the Inquisition, until the Inquisition found them in the New World as well. But nonetheless, their genome survived and got transmitted. Here is a cohort of women with Laronne syndrome in Quito. They actually live in the Loja province of Ecuador with the endocrinologists Jaime Guevara and Arlen Rosenblum. This was at the time that Jaime and Arlen did their first study with the population. You can see the subjects with Laronne syndrome change their dress over time, but they're really quite short. Their average stature is about 3.5 feet tall. Oops. Here is Jaime with a little less hair 20 years later compared to at the time of their discovery. And so we studied this population, and in fact, we found that not only were their mutations the same, but some of their strands of DNA, especially those of European origin, were ones that had been derived from Converso Jews. And quite remarkably, just 2 weeks ago, a paper was published in Nature Communications that was much larger than ours, much more widely based geographically, that came to the same conclusion that Latin Americans show widespread Converso ancestry and imprint of local native ancestry on physical appearance. And so here is a map, maybe a little bit hard to see in this light, but it shows that these populations with Converso ancestry are pretty well dispersed throughout Latin America, in Mexico, in northern South America, along the Pacific coast. I should note that equatorial Brazil was not studied. It just wasn't part of the study, but I suspect that we would find a significant representation of Converso Jewish ancestry there. The average was about 5%. In some places, the fraction of ancestry that was ascribed to Converso Jews was significantly higher. So I would argue to you that the stakes in Jewish population genetic discoveries are high. These include a line of identity beyond belief, cultural observance, Zionism, and Holocaust remembrance. We have a shared genetic ancestry, a claim for Jewish homeland in Israel based on Middle Eastern genetic origins. We and Palestinians, Druze, and Bedouins have a shared genetic legacy in the Middle East. Glorious lines of descent from Aaron the priest, but not King David. I'm not going to elaborate on that now. We can talk about that more if you would like. Absolution from Christ killing based on non-Semitic lines of descent. We weren't there at the time that Christ was crucified, therefore we cannot be held accountable for that. Potentially even insight into Jewish exceptionalism. So in my book, I argue Jewish genetics is unlikely to replace the hegemony of Jewish law and Jewish culture, nor should it. But as population genetics gains a foothold in the community, with Jews and non-Jews alike wanting to know about their origins, ancestors, and relatives, it will take its place in the formation of group identity alongside shared spirituality, shared social values, and a shared cultural legacy. So thank you all very much for listening. These are my many